Perfect. And then I will also pop up the closed captioning just for fun. Oh, and I need to get back to the beginning. So today we are going to pretty much go over just kind of like an update of where we're at. Essentially, we're going to have Alex come on and give us an update about the Zero Waste Salem project that she has. She has a great Facebook page, and she tries to do quite a bit of work there. So she's going to give us an update about that. Also, the Reduce, Reuse, Recycle, Rethink grant, that is now up and out. And I'll give just a brief overview. And then also last month we reported, or Taylor reported on a survey for kind of perceptions of people using reusables during COVID and beyond. And so we'll talk just shortly about that. Rachel, I don't know if you want to chat about that once the screen comes up, but since you mostly work with Taylor, that might be great. And then we'll also talk about the Library of Things. And I pretty much hijacked Clackamas's slides and talk about their process of how they handle it. And then talk about how we're going to move that into our communities. And then if you guys have projects that you want to share about your zero waste projects, feel free, or ideas or questions, we'll definitely have time for that as well. So I think we had Alex up front, but we'll add her to the end. So let's just talk about the Reduce, Reuse, Recycle, Rethink grant. This year is a little bit different. So we have for-profit businesses that can apply to this. And it just got released, at the beginning of this month, end of July. So essentially these grant monies can be used to pay for any reduction, reuse, recycling, and rethinking kind of campaigns that you can think of, or any community work. And they this year have two kind of ideas that they're approaching things through. They want to focus on equity, diversity, and inclusion, which is awesome. And then focus on getting access to materials and whatnot for historically marginalized communities. So when I first read about that, I thought how perfect that is for the Library of Things, because the library is already focused on access, and that's been a primary focus for them for a long time, as well as the diversity and equity and inclusion is pretty much written into any of their plans moving forward, their strategic plans. So I definitely brought that up when I had a meeting with them, but I also want you guys to think of businesses in your community or possible projects in your community and think about ways that we can promote that. So perhaps you have a favorite bike repair shop. Maybe you want to send them this information. So the links here, you can even just go and it's a really quick Google search of DEQ materials management grants, essentially. And they have, I think it's $600,000 for this year to dole out. And usually the grants are $12,000 to $60,000 that they offer lump sums to people. And they're also really great of, if they can't fund all the ones that they want to, they'll reach out to those businesses or organizations and try to say, okay, what's your minimum? You know, what can we offer that would be of help? So I applaud them for their work, and they've funded some really great projects in the past. Does anybody have any questions about that? Okay. And then there's also, once you go to this page too, I'm trying to see if they have it now, but they did have some really great and informative meeting. And they're going to be putting up a link to that meeting too. So that's already happened in the past. So they'll have that link coming shortly. All right, Rachel, are you okay chatting about the survey?
Sure.
Okay.
So again, we are loving that we have our intern Taylor with us through the summer. One of the things that she is really focusing on for us is looking at obviously using COVID as a springboard, but looking at how do we gauge people's perceptions about the safety and sanitary conditions of reusables in restaurants, even in a non-pandemic, but you know, if, even when you're talking like things like flu season and things like that. She's working with Marion County Health to make sure that our information is this meeting up with what is the regulations in Marion County. And she is creating a really wonderful reusable guide for us for restaurants that will have cost analysis. It'll also have a breakout piece about steps workers can take to make sure reusables are safe and sanitary, and some really great links to things that we're not seeing. A National Restaurant Association says right now reusables are perfectly safe to use. There's quite a bit of research from different folks about reusables during COVID and flu season that's just not getting out there. So she's been doing great. I think there you have it up. 687 folks for the consumer side, 7 for the restaurant side on the survey. But we will be working with Marion County Health Department to access their restaurant database to reach out to a few more people. Orla, I think, is this week posting this link. So a few more people will be able to do that. And then when the food waste reduction grant from Earthwise comes out, hopefully early August, beginning of September, I'm waiting on some paperwork. This will actually be part of the application is to complete this survey. So we really are getting quite a bit of good information about how people think about durables right now. Great to see this in kind of counteracting. I see, watch it on Hulu and I cringe, the Dixie Cup commercial where it's like, during the pandemic, just make your life easy and use paper products the whole time in your house 24/7. And I cringe a little and have to walk it off. But she's doing some really great work. I think we're gonna be able to get some great data out of this that we can continue to use and share with the community and share with other folks who might have an interest. Really quick, I'm going to piggyback on the DEQ grant. We are looking at, we passed that DEQ information to Church at the Park so that their folks can look at that grant for their Trash for Cash program. We're hoping that we can help get that funded so it can continue and solidify. As right now, I believe every Friday they're having about 135 people average turning in bags of trash. So this is a kind of the grant that's perfect for them. We reached out to them, and we also had some people from Republic Services reach out to them about maybe piggybacking that with a small community grant from them as well. So it is, I really do encourage you guys, if you have a business that you just think, oh, this would be a great fit, send them the link and let them go watch the webinar. There's just so many great projects out there that I think deserve to have a little bit of funding here in the county. So share.
Absolutely. And so Rachel's going to be working on getting more information out about the upcoming grant for the restaurants. But if you know a favorite restaurant, that's why we put it on the reduce-reuse.net. It's just its own page, its own, you know, there's no other competing information. So, you know, maybe you know the owners of the Epilogue, reach out to them and say, hey, do you mind filling this out for really good information?
Chance to win a $100 gift card from Cash and Carry.
Yep. And then thank you to everyone who did the consumer survey as well. Thank you, Rachel. Alex, are you okay being up talking about Zero Waste Salem?
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
I'm Alex. And yeah, I'm doing Zero Waste Salem, which is a page on Facebook that you can join. And there's a link right there. It looks so good. I love that. It's a group in which we can share our ideas about zero waste and living a zero waste lifestyle, what that looks like, both on daily habits, but socially and economically as well. And also I try to host a monthly cleanup event, which will be taking place this Wednesday, actually. And I just select a location that I see needs a little bit of a pick-me-up. And I work with the city of Salem for the Adopt a Street program. So I have two streets that I've adopted. And so I kind of use their gear, vests and gloves and whatnot, and go to those areas and do a little bit of a cleanup. So that's happening this Wednesday at 11 o'clock. And that will be across the street from Safeway downtown. There's kind of a little field that I noticed needs a cleaning. So, and then depending on how well that goes and who joins that, we'll see about going around the outside of Safeway as well, maybe that area, and kind of just checking that out. Also, this is not Salem based, but I'm going to be doing carpooling for this. We're going to be doing a cleanup on Tuesday as well from 5 to 8 in Portland for the Black Lives Matter protests that are going on. They need a little bit of help with that. And there's going to be a guy there who specializes in removing graffiti. So he's going to be joining us for that as well, and helping us get some of that graffiti off the walls, do a little bit of a cleanup. And then depending on how everyone feels afterwards, maybe join in on the peaceful protest, depending on the opinions of the people who are coming. So far it's just me, so but we'll see how it goes. That's on Tuesday. So and then also personally, I'm working on getting a free library built in my front yard. I still haven't decided what kind of structure I'm gonna go with. I really want to do zero waste type style, but I'm kind of scatterbrained, a little ADHD, having a hard time deciding what route I want to take, or if I just want to buy one from the website and go that route and build it. But I feel like, I don't know. We'll see how that goes. But I got, I emailed and got, I forget what it's called, kind of like where they come and check what's in your ground and make sure that, I forget what it's called, but I got that done, took a picture of it. So that made me feel like things are moving forward on that. So I'll keep in touch with you guys, and next month I'll let you know how that's going. So that's where I'm at.
And if you have any questions, we can always stay on the call. I have a little free library. I'm wondering if other people do. If you have any questions, we can stick around too to answer any tips, kind of.
Yeah. And there was a girl who was here last month as well, Marion, I believe her name was, and she was discussing wanting to do that as well. So maybe we can kind of share our experiences as we go and see how that goes, maybe inspire a few more as well, especially since the library is down right now. Its capacity is much down because they're on construction and COVID and whatnot. So let's get these free libraries going out. So yeah, that's it.
Awesome. Great work. Thank you, Alex.
Uh-huh.
All right. So let's get back. So now, library of things. So essentially, I nabbed this slideshow. This is, I think Anne was my first introduction to the library of things, I'm thinking, from a blue jean swap, and we were chatting about stuff. And I think she's the first one who told me about it. But this is one that I saw at the Association of Organ Recyclers at a presentation there. So essentially their library of things, it's pretty much a collection of non-traditional things that a library can loan out. So anything beyond things that are currently getting loaned out, like books and journals and media, we're used to libraries doing that. But beyond that, like a sewing machine, a radon detector, a tripod, things that people need maybe infrequently, but don't need to necessarily purchase. So from that list, you know, anything that you can pretty much think of that people can share in this sharing economy. So a lot of libraries, I think, start with games. I think that's a good test for some libraries because you have to keep track of these little teeny tiny components. Are they going to return? You know, things like that. But our library in Salem already has an object on here on the screen, and it's a ukulele. Mm-hmm. And do you did you check out ukuleles at the Salem Public Library?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So mm-hmm. when you would get them back, were they usually in good condition?
They were in excellent condition. We had really good success with lending those. But we had a really good system set up. So, you know, we kind of thought of all the contingencies. And it worked out really well.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I think a lot of these things can work out well. And I think because a library already has a system of checking in and checking out and a process of making sure things are maintained, I think a library makes a really good choice when it comes to having a library of things or a tool library. So essentially their benefits, things like you get to try it before you buy it. These things all help promote sustainability. And that's why Marion County is really interested in helping with this project. Encouraging sharing and waste reduction. And perhaps somebody wants to just check out something that they're never going to buy, but they're going on that hiking trip and they need a tent or, you know, something that they do seasonally and they don't want to have, you know, the space to store it, and then they don't want to have the upfront costs. And then also it provides access to anybody who has a card can be able to check these things out. It's also really socially rewarding too, to see a community come together and help one another, either through events that can happen through a library of things, or even just getting together and checking out a game for game night, and you're all gonna play with friends and you're able to say that your library helped you with that. I think that's really cool. And then also it promotes the library's mission of getting people to explore and discover and be continuous, fostering their creativity and their curiosity. So essentially, the libraries are really great places to house a little free library, a library of things, because they already have the equity kind of piece figured out, because anybody can be a part of a library, and it's open to the public. They also have the risk management piece figured out, and we were able to connect with Clackamas, and Clackamas has 12 different library of things, and they've already come up with a risk management plan of how are we going to maintain these things, what's going to happen if somebody returns it to the wrong place, what happens if they break it. So those are all things that need to be thought of well in advance before the program comes into place. And then the library also already has a platform of checking in and checking out. Like, I think that's the number one thing, is like, Anne was the expert at all of that. And the more we can rely on that rather than building a whole new system, the better we're going to be. Also, they have a great reach. They have hundreds of people visit them. So how, you know, there's no difference of a need between reading versus checking out music versus checking out a game. So these are people that are already coming to this central location, this community space. And then also we have a lot of just crossover of our programs. As waste reduction coordinators, our job is, of course, to promote the waste reduction piece, but it's also to educate people about how can you start living a less wasteful life, how we can use an Instant Pot to make yogurt, and that's going to make your life better. So we're really looking forward to having those kind of partnerships with the library through events and whatnot, so we can kind of push out our mission even further. And then there's also the opportunities of events. So like meetups, repair fairs, we already host repair fairs in Marion County. And then I also spoke with Sarah, the director at the library, as well as the foundation executive director. And they said with their planning of this new space, they're going to have, and I forget what they called it, but it's kind of like a makerspace. It's a community hub. And do you remember what they coined that thing? I don't either. And I've asked my daughter, and she can't remember either.
Yeah, but, I'm farther out of this loop than you think I am.
I also don't want to be disrespectful, because I know you know a lot of things.
I don't, I've been away a while though, so.
Yeah, which is fine, and you're retired, you're allowed to do those things. But essentially what the library was looking at their new space and renovating the building, they did a lot of outreach and chatting with, you know, community members, inviting them to come in and say what's important to them. And I remember at the time saying how important a makerspace or a library of things would be. And I of course got the ear of my daughter, who's on the teen advisory board, and also whispered the same things. And then she told them as well, as a teen, those are things that they're looking forward to in that space. And I think we're kind of in a transition between libraries. You know, a lot of people have thought of them as traditional places to check out books, but a lot of libraries have moved into these other kind of fields. So a maker space where people can utilize an iron or a sewing machine and utilize it in that space is already somewhat planned. So this wouldn't be a huge stretch for the library to move forward with a library of things. And then also just having classes based on the library of things is really important. So when Clackamas opened, they had a petting zoo, which I thought was way cute, of their library of things. So they had all the things out. People could pick them up, they can play with them, they can interact with it, and they could see the possibilities of how this can make their lives better. So essentially, this is kind of how Clackamas got their library things in place. So it took them about a year from start to finish, it looks like, and maybe a year and a half almost. So essentially they reached out to just a couple of the libraries at first, and then they realized it was going to expand because a lot more libraries are engaged and excited about this project. They also had some revenue that they were going to share. Essentially, they ended up calculating it to be $1,500 per library on top of 35 cents per capita of unincorporated citizens. So that sounds like a crazy way to figure it out. But essentially they were saying, as a county, we want to contribute our county share as much as possible. So that's what they ended up doing. And then from there, they started talking to the library directors. They formed a committee. They also toured the libraries that already had them in the state that had Library of Things. So Hillsborough has them, Beaverton has them. I think in Lynn Benton, they have one as well. So there's definite opportunities possibly for us post-COVID to go tour. But until then, we get to hopefully see some behind the scenes tours maybe. Maybe they'll host that for us. I think that would be really cool. So like I said, just a few they, you know, thought were going to be part of this group, and then eventually eight libraries started joining. And so then they started thinking about the funding, what are they going to do with there? Then they started surveying their patrons, which I'll show in a minute about what that survey turned out to look like. And then they were also really worried about the, you know, the risks, the operations, what does that look like for the longevity, the marketing, communications, as well as how do we know this is a successful thing after the first year? So they pretty much lays that all out for us, which is great. And then they launched the petting zoo of things. So when they surveyed their people, the things in orange are the ones that people came back saying that was most important thing for them to have in a library of things. So arts and crafts is already there. Home equipment, media, technology was also big, and recreational and outdoor equipment was also really big. And it's interesting here seeing it, because on the, there's another slide too. I'll show you the next one. That kind of, it looks a little bit different. This one's just the general one of all the ages together. So this one is by age and interest, which is a little different. Mm-hmm. So here we can see for kids under the age of 10, wow, they love their toys and games, which makes sense, right? So, and I'm guessing probably less kids filled it out, so it wasn't as weighted as heavily on that previous screen that we saw. But it here is really nice just to see the differences of people's interests. Arts and crafts is still really high here. Home and garden, of course, is not that interesting to anybody under the age of 20, apparently. They don't want to weed, and I don't blame them. But home equipment and technology is important for all ages, and I think we're definitely seeing that now in the time of COVID as well. So other things that they thought was important was, of course, space. I think that's huge. So between space and time. So they said you could have, 350 to 600 square feet can probably hold about 100 to 400 items for checkout. And when they're talking about space, they're also talking about, they put them in clear containers that are pretty, tight and well secured, so things aren't bouncing around in there. But they're also making sure that that box is going to be maintained and that's holding the item, so it's not going to be broken or whatever. And then inventory space might be minimal because you might have some things on checkout or hold, essentially. But I think the number one issue for most of the spaces is the time aspect, because it does take a librarian a lot of time to check in and out these things, to maintain the things, and then continuously, just handle any of the processing. So here they have an estimated hours per work week, and I haven't checked with them to see how much this has changed moving forward, or if it has. But I guess in Hillsborough, they do have a full-time person just handling the library of things. So it can be a lot of time. So I think that's tough for, anybody who has a very limited budget, which I think all governments do, right? So how do we make sure that time piece is accounted for in their operations? Other things that I think are kind of difficult to move forward are just pushback from citizens. So when I was there and they were talking about the renovations of the library, a lovely lady who I really enjoy and got in an argument with me about having a library of things or having a makerspace. And she said, that's not what libraries are for. And I said, are you kidding? And so we had a conversation, kind of a back and forth. And eventually, I saw her at another event later, and she said, yeah, I realized, because she said, other places are doing this for the community. I'm like, not that I know of. And she got back to me, and she said, Jess, I realized that we don't have community centers for young kids here. We have a senior center, but it's not open to everyone. So I think being really thoughtful about how we discuss these perceived problems for people is going to be smart moving forward. So some of the things that people have said is, for instance, libraries are about books. That's kind of true, but we could also look at our mission of the Salem Public Library. So it serves the community by promoting and providing opportunities for full and equal access to information and ideas. The love of reading, the joy of learning, and engagement with the art, sciences, and humanities in a safe and comfortable environment. So while there is the word reading in there, I think that also the equal access to information and ideas and the engagement piece the lifelong learner aspect can definitely be reached through libraries. So that's just one of them. Other people are saying, that isn't how the libraries used to be. That's not how it used to be. Why are we doing that now? And essentially, this is a kind of a graph showing the different places throughout the nation that offers really non-traditional things. So Port Townsend and Washington Public Library, they have American Girl dolls that they can check out, which is super fun. They have microscopes in Ann Arbor, Michigan. This isn't out of the norm, I think, for a lot of libraries. And I remember Anne telling me that at one point, and I was like, really? And then I did a little bit more research, and this is what we came up with. Also, I think people think that libraries were always traditionally books, but we've been doing different non-traditional checking out materials for a while now. In the Salem Public Library, I don't know how far back the VHS tapes have gone, the music is gone. I don't know, Anne, if you were even around there at the time, but it's got to be some time to be a VHS tape to check out, right? But in like 1904, a New Jersey library in Newark was checking out artwork for people, framed artwork that they could check out. And then in like 1943, a Boys Work Committee and Grosse Pointe Rotary Club sponsored a tool collection. So people could check out tools, especially during, there was a scarcity of tools during the wartime. And so they made this gift of tools for kids to check out. So while we say it's not traditional, I think there are other ways to reach a community other than just books. And then also, why are we doing these things? So the Library of Things opened for in Clackamas, September 23rd, 2019. And this is kind of their statistics. It showed 2,800 items were checked out over the next 4 months. That's a lot of things. And surveys showed that 94% of patrons were satisfied or very satisfied with the program. And 99.5% plan to borrow again. So getting that recirculation of people of being interested in this program is a lot. And it helped enrich their lives. So people were trying an item, they were maybe considering buying, 26% said that. 25% said they avoid buying the item if they only needed it once or occasionally. And it's also a great way to save money, learn a new skill, and build connections with others. So this really speaks to the waste reduction piece of why this program is such an important one. We keep saying, be a thoughtful consumer. And I think the Library of Things really helps people rethink that. So does anybody have any questions? That's all I have for this really kind of quick. I can also just talk about a little bit about how the meeting went. So that was last week. I think it was like the 4th of August that I had. So it was the director and the foundation executive director. And so essentially I said, hey, guess what? Now's a great time because DEQ has these grants. We could help with some of the funding as well. What can we do to move forward? And so they are having an estimated time of reopening would be July of 2021. And so this is really gives them a lot of time to start planning these things. And so from there, it was a really good meeting. And we're hoping to work on grant writing from there. And they said the majority of their concern would be the time that it takes to maintain this and how do we make this a sustainable program for years to come. And I think Marion County could be a really good partner, and I know that DEQ can as well if of course get awarded with a grant. But knowing what the grant is looking for, I just think this is such a perfect marriage. So I'm excited, and I think they are too. So I can keep you guys in the loop, but eventually I might need some help reaching out to people to take surveys, to get more information. Also, I'd love your ideas about how you think we should maybe move forward and reaching out to community members. All right, that's all I got. Also, if you can think of ways to reach out to other libraries, I think that would be good as well. I was willing to work on the City of Salem only because Anne hooked us up years ago talking to Sarah. So we already had that relationship established. And Sarah comes from Hillsborough Library that has a library thing. So it wasn't a hard sell. She's seen its impact. But I do think there's people in the community that really care about books want to see their library mostly focus on that. So I do think moving forward, we might need to do a lot of just educating people of what can be. Anybody have questions? Okay.
Sounds like you've done a great job, Jessica.
No, what's wonderful is like all I had to do was say, hey, Clackamas, what do you have? And they like share everything. I love that about librarians and government workers in general. So it makes life much easier. Okay. So the next thing on the agenda, gosh, this meeting's going pretty fast. Does anybody have any wasteless or zero waste or reuse projects that they're working on and want to share?
No.
I do.
Yay! Okay.
We're starting a free fridge sale, you guys.
A free what?
It's called Free Fridge Salem is what it's going to be called. And it's modeled after the free fridge projects that are going on in the larger cities, so in Portland and Eugene. And it's basically the same idea as a community pantry, but it's with a refrigerator. So you're able to offer a lot more stuff for community members. I have watched, being in the county, I've watched the lines grow where they're giving food boxes, and a lot of these places are at churches and from faith-based, you know, organizations, and I don't like that part of it. And I know there's a lot of people right here in our community that are unsheltered because of organized religion, and so they would never go to one of those programs. And I don't, there's always, I do have, you know, an underlying, like, trying to eliminate food waste here too, hoping that people will just, you know, take all that zucchini and make something and put it in a fridge, or, you know, so there is underlying little master recycler to it. But I think of not only of the unsheltered community, and I know that there's a lot of people just struggling, you know, in general. And yeah, I think if someone can just go to a fridge on their own free time, and they don't have to talk to anybody, or no one has to pray for them, or they don't have to receive a pamphlet, or, you know, yeah, so of course my first place was the carousel. So I already threw it out to Marie, the director down there, and she's going to talk to them tomorrow.
Wow, that's
about
awesome.
It. So it's like moving. Yes, yes. So I'm so super excited. I just feel like the other pieces of getting a fridge and building, you know, I feel like that will come together really quickly, because there's already so many people that want to help. And they just don't necessarily have, like, oh, at the end of my property, I have a outlet that you can use. You know, there's not a lot of that. So, but a lot of interest.
I do not know anything about this project, Summer. Could you tell me a little bit about the specifics of what somebody needs to host this? So do they need to be open to the public? Does it need to be in a sheltered area? All of that.
Technically, no. So when I talked to the city of Salem about it, the city of Kaiser, of course, wouldn't even talk to me. but when I talked to the city of Salem about it, they were basically like, we don't know anything, so just go ahead and go for it. So, eventually, that will probably run into problems. But right now, like in Portland, and like I have a friend in Eugene that's hosting a fridge, and it's literally at the end of their property where it just so happened where their fence was, there was an outlet. So yeah, and they just have a small fridge there with a small pantry, but it's in, you know, a great neighborhood for people that need it. So yeah, it just works exactly like a community pantry, with people from the community filling it, and then whoever needs it, taking stuff.
Love it.
And yeah. Summer, so,
some great selling points on that, because I was so excited when I saw your post on that, because I've seen it in some other cities in the U.S., and I believe they're very big in Thailand and Vietnam now. One of the things that, when you talk about food waste and really how perfect these are, is you have unsheltered population that could use fresh food or, cold food, dairy, but don't have a large place to store it. So, we have these wonderful, the farmer food boxes right now, which for families are awesome. But if you are living in a tent, you probably do not have enough room in your cooler for what they're giving. So it allows you to not waste something, to take exactly what you need. The other thing is, we have a lot of people and a lot of families living in hotels right now, and those little fridges just do not hold a lot. So it is very hard for them to sometimes go one time once a week and get a great amount. Or, this does provide a lot of access. I know Marion Polk, the whole county has been doing well at looking at this, but given the fact that a large population of people that are using food pantries have at least one working member, if not two people with two not well-paid jobs, three to five might not work for them, nine to noon might not work for them, but exactly like you said, on my way home, I swing by the pantry and grab something that I can use right there. So there's a lot of great benefits, as far as I think you've hit on them, that we can really kind of have those conversations with people about access and dignity. So food choices.
Yes, yes. And that's, that's a big piece for me, is I've already had some people reach out and say, well, we would, like some businesses saying that they would love to host a fridge, but I always have that accessibility piece that I really try to think about, So, we have such a large population that are living unsheltered that are disabled, and they're using wheelchairs and they have their carts and they have, walkers. And so while I know every fridge is not going to be accessible for everyone, I would like to always keep that at the forefront of trying to make sure that it is accessible for everybody, because not everybody has someone to help them, especially if they're going in the evening or, early in the morning or whenever. So.
Cool. I don't want to cut anybody else off. Does anybody have any more questions for Summer?
Go
ahead.
I was just going to say, and I know you've had some experience with this too, Jessica, that it's a great idea, and I don't want to rain on anybody's parade or discourage anybody, but Free Little Libraries have had some vandalism, and I would expect that there would be at least a little bit of that. So we just have to keep that in mind.
Yeah, my husband said it really well, though, at some point it was a cold winter and we just kept getting our books taken. And who knows, it could have been to be burnt, it could have been to whatever. Maybe it was given out for gifts, who knows. But my husband said, Jess, they need them more than we do. And I do think that it's free, and we can be upset about that. And but we also, part of a community is dealing with sometimes not the most fun part of a community too, but allowing all of that to happen. And other than that, we have had delightful experiences. I cannot say how much more I love our little free library. So I would never want that to be a reason, because there's a couple of bad apples to spoil it for everyone.
I agree.
Yeah. Thank you, Judy. Thank
you.
But kind of like a library, what happens when that happens? Do we need to have these things in place? What happens if the power goes out? All of those things,
Yep.
Probably could be thoughtful. My question to you, so can you put a fridge outside and just let it be, or should it be in a sheltered area, Summer? I have no clue. I'm not an electrician.
The suggestion is to shelter it, to build a shelter around it, cool. and actually enclose the fridge. Cool. And then you have, you know, ideally you would build the shelter a little bit bigger than the fridge, so then you could have those, you know, canned goods or breads or, I mean, our area is so incredibly abundant with giving away bread, you know, that everybody has bread.
Do you think you would apply for a grant at all, do you think, moving forward? Like, could, I mean,
I'm not sure. Right now I'm hoping it can just be community powered, because there's been such a huge outreach from people that just want to help share in keeping it stocked, to people that, you know, say, well, I'll go by and sanitize, or I'll clean, or I'll make sure that, you know, things are picked up, or, you know, because there's that piece of it too, with, you know, there's always going to be that person that's going to open that fridge, eat something, and throw the wrapper right on the ground, you know? Right. Right. So there's that part of thinking about it all too. So
totally. The other thing I thought of is, maybe I wonder if J&L Appliances, who's a local appliance store, they have a lot of refurbished stuff too. I absolutely love them. And they also have a lot of things. I wonder if they could help sponsor, or if I can imagine getting a full size fridge might be somewhat of a tricky thing. So I'm not sure what that is. Yeah. I would love to help.
Thank you.
So the other thing too, if you could send me any information you have on that, and maybe really think about the ask too. What action would you like our group to take, or the people that we're sending it to, and then I can send it out to the people that's on our list so far.
That's really kind, and I have no idea.
Okay. We're all just playing pretend world right now. So that's
I'm trying to make leg warmers over here, Jessica.
I love it.
Well, and Summer, Jessica, when you were talking, go ahead, Judy.
I'll try and send you some information. It turns out that newer fridges are much, much more efficient energy wise, and their environment has a lot to do with that. They were not really built to be on the back porch. They were meant to be in a conditioned space. That doesn't mean this, I always think of the negative things, and I try not to be I don't want to rain on anybody's parade. But there are some things to think about with that.
Yeah. And I think getting a partner like JL Appliance might be really good to,
I agree.
Say, okay, mm-hmm. Is there one that you wouldn't fix, or one that's not worth investing in? But I can also say those old ones are built to friggin' last, unlike the stuff that I find. You know, it's like planned obsolescence. But the problem is when we have a government that hasn't put the, you know, $600 back into the pockets of people when they're out of work with COVID, how do we take care of our populace and make it sustainable too? I hear about the sustainability. I really do.
Well, and I think, Summer, like, as you were talking about this, and like the people are saying it would be great to have it, you know, like sheltered, you know, I'm thinking, you know, we have all these high school kids in the one school that has the woodworking that might be looking for an independent project. And we have a lot of artists, some in this group, that could do some really beautiful artwork to make these things, wherever it's somebody's property or a business, just look absolutely gorgeous and have it be something that people really kind of just love doing, love having that art there, love having.
Does anybody know if Rebecca Maitland is still in town? Is anybody familiar with her? But she did the Art-a-Potty program
where they did porta potties and wrapped them in art. And I can imagine this having the same kind of struggles and barriers that that project has, but also probably has the same kind of built-in partnerships that might be able to help you out right now. So like those businesses that have already signed up for that kind of program would be probably more than willing moving forward to sign up for this. And I don't know if she's moved to the beach, but it would be good to reach out to her about it. Cause I know that it was a long, many, many years working on that project.
Yeah. Yes. I say yes to it all. Yes.
Cool. That's really exciting. I love it. Anybody else has a reuse or waste reduction project moving forward? Leg warmers, bringing the 80s back.
Hey, winter's going to be here before we know it.
Oh, I'm continuing.
Keep your ankles warm.
Yes, of course. Although probably not quite so much when it's 95. I'm continuing to work on recycling oddball stuff. Candle wax, CD cases. I got another of the things you build a reef on. And I'm looking for creative people to pass them along to, so that by Christmas they might be a reef, or maybe for another season. So I always have oddball stuff like that going on. If you're looking for something weird, I might know where to find it.
Thank you, Judy.
I do have for folks trying to figure out kind of maybe where we can do this. Obviously not right now with burn season being as it is, but as we move into the winter months, some of you guys know that my husband is a very avid woodworker. Summer's laughing. She knows some of my trips around the state of Oregon to pick up reclaimed wood. But what he does is he does three kinds of fire starters, which literally we have pieces of stored in our garage right now. Some of them are made from sawdust and wax. Some of them are made from shredded paper and wax. And some of them are made for coffee and wax. And they are great fire starters as people are moving into maybe leaving fires in the safer months for campfires or, you know, fire pits or however that is, that they need a little bit of warmth. We are more than happy to be rehoming them to people. My once fondue pot, you know, is now been put to work as a wax smelter. So he buys out the estate sale candles and he just literally will keep his big trash cans full of sawdust and his molds. And he just found a brick maker. So now they're actually in bricks. So they will get a fire starting burning for about 30 to 45 minutes. So as we move into colder, wetter months, if you know someone for needs for that or organizations with needs for that, please just reach out. We can share them.
I do know some folks up in the canyon that are going to be, that give things out to people that are homeless or semi-sheltered. I also know an awesome wax recycler in Lebanon, and she's always got leftovers and things, and she makes them. He probably doesn't need to buy wax. We can probably get him as much as he wants.
That would be awesome, because right now what he does is he goes to estate sales and he picks up the box of candles and goes, how much for this? And they go $2 and they're like, oh, you're into candles? And he's like, no, not at all. And he just carries his big boxes of candles. So some of these are even scented. So I'm just saying. But yeah, Judy, as we get closer to people maybe needing campfires, if you have an organization you think could take them, reach out to me and we'll get some out there to people.
And we can get you some wax too.
Awesome.
Anyone else?
I have a couple random questions. Is it question time? So I had some people ask me questions on Instagram. So one person asked me if anyone knew about the solar panel project that's going on in Oregon for homeowners to get free solar panels.
Yes? I do not, actually.
Oh, okay.
You reached out to somebody. I don't know if anybody else, though. I don't mean to, but Energy Trust of Oregon might be the best bet.
Okay.
Because yeah. I think there are some people that, you know, are certified installers that you might want to make sure they're accredited to move forward.
Gotcha. And that's the thing, Summer. I would direct everyone to Energy Trust of Oregon, their solar program. Okay. I've seen a lot of teasers like that on social media.
Maybe that's where it's coming from.
And then when they get people get into that, and also if they're working with somebody, the first question I would tell people is, are they a trade ally of Energy Trust? If they're not, I would personally be a little wary. There's a lot of steps that someone has to go to become a trade ally with them. The other thing is, as a trade ally, you know exactly what the rebates are. So while the solar panels may be free, you may be looking at $6,000 in installation. From a business that will not be named right now, if they don't tell you that your roof is not structurally sound to hold that weight, then you have a problem later down the road. So I have seen them, their little Facebook ads, Oregon zero down free solar panels. But if folks are serious about it, go to the there's great incentives and great ROIs for homeowners on solar. But if it's not too good to be true, with things like that, it usually is.
And for the most part, to be eligible for energy, either have Pacific Power, PGE, or Northwest Natural. There are a couple smaller ones. Go to their website, it has all that. But if you have Salem Electric, maybe not so much. They may have their own program because they're a co-op.
Right. All right. And the other question was about, okay, so I was out delivering groceries to someone in Turner, and I've noticed that there's a spot where people are dropping their garbage and furniture, and now it's growing. It used to just be one office chair, and now it's, you know, growing. Like, is there someone to call, or do I just pick it up, or I don't know what to do? But every time I drive, I'm like, I can't keep driving mine.
I think one of the first places might be Marion County's Public Works Dispatch, and they can try to look into it. I know a lot of people, at least on the side of the road, they get rid of stuff a lot, and so they try to help pick that up. But at least they can try to figure out, is that their jurisdiction? Is it the city's? Is it private property? All of that stuff, and investigate it from there.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
You're keeping an eye on it because, like you said, it can expand quickly.
Right. I just put a sign up out there that said, this area is patrolled by cameras. So I don't know, but it's just garbage, you know, but it's not like trash. It's more just like junk. But now I feel like people are just, it's growing. So thank you so much.
No problem.
So do you live in Turner, or you just happen to be there?
No, I live in Kaiser. I run a part-time service, community service, just doing things for community members. And someone contacted me out in Turner and needed groceries. So I went out there and I noticed this spot.
One of the things that I participate in, and it has worked better in the canyon that it has in Salem. It actually started, I think, in Polk County, but it's called Service Integration. And we have a group for Cascade High School, which, or Cascade School District, which includes Turner, North Sandingham District, which includes Staten, and Sandingham Canyon, which goes all the way up to Idana. And people in those groups, in those areas, can apply for help for, and they are thoroughly screened, and then different groups can decide whether they want to help or not. And it's been awesome. But it hasn't, besides R3 and whatever Polk County's doing, we haven't, no other groups that I know of have sprung up. And it was funded half by the school district and half by the hospital. And of course, our little independent hospital has lots of, is very well known in the community and does a lot of outreach. And so, but I know that Salem's a bigger neighborhood, which makes it a lot harder. But if anybody wants more information, let me know.
Great. Well, thanks, Judy. And then, Alex, if you want to stick around for a little free library stuff, let me know. If not, that's fine, too.
Not now. I can message you about that, but I got to go tuck my kiddo in. So I told him.
Yeah, it's bedtime. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone, for participating, and we'll try to do this again next month. But if you have questions, feel free to email me in the meantime, all right? All right.
Okay, sounds good. Bye.